I'm Deepak Kannal, the ex-dean of Faculty of Fine Arts, MS University of Baroda. In the previous session, we saw how the bhava reaches the status of rasa and how rasa can be considered as an aesthetic experience. Now, Bharata himself does not necessarily make a committed statement, a categorical statement that rasa is aesthetic experience. He said uchyate aswadyatvat. But whether rasa is an aesthetic experience, rasa is an object, if it is an object, where does it lie? All these questions may rise from this discussion. In short, if you remember our first session, we were talking about philosophy and various philosophical inquiries. If you remember, I talked about ontology as one of the philosophical inquiries, which tries to inquire into the existence of something. The same inquiry can be applied to rasa at this juncture. Whether rasa actually exists? Is rasa a reality? Or rasa is merely an imagination? When you talk about the experience of rasa, do you really experience rasa? Do you really think that something happens and the rasa emerges out of it and gives you a different kind of experience, or you only imagine the rasa? We are not very sure about it, and the scholars like Bhatta Lolata and Bhatta Nayaka have raised questions about it. There is the questions about the ontological status of the notion called rasa. They ask whether rasa really emerges from the work of art, or the viewer imagines it, whether it is the viewer's contribution. Now, in Indian aesthetics, the viewer's contribution has been given a lot of importance. This is very important. In the Western tradition, the artist is considered to be a genius, and he is the person who does everything. But we seldom forget, probably because all this discussion has been done in the context of theater, Bharata is aware of the contribution of the audience all the time. You know that a play becomes a play only when the audience is in front of it. If you do the same thing without the audience, it is called rehearsal. It is not a play. It becomes a play when the audience is there. A work of art becomes a work of art only after getting a sanction from the viewer. If the viewer doesn't sanction it, it is not a sculpture. Do you get my point? If I place this chair in front of you and call it a sculpture, if you approve of it, it becomes a sculpture. Do you get my point? So the approval of the rasika is mandatory in any aesthetic activity. And very surprisingly, the Indian aesthetics has taken cognizance of this very, very important fact right from the beginning, right from Bharata to the later scholars. And that is why the sumanasa or rasika has been given a lot of importance in the art activity of India. Even in Vatsyayana's Kama Sutra, Vatsyayana speaks about the Suruda, a cultivated connoisseur. A connoisseur is very, very important, a person who understands the value of art, the person who understands the intricacies of art. If such a connoisseur is not there, the art activity is futile. Yesterday, I recited Sher to some of my friends, that there is a very interesting Sher that hazaro saal nargis apni benure pe roti hai, badi mushkil se hota hai chaman mein didavar paida. Nargis is a very rare flower that blooms in the desert, and there is nobody to look at its beauty, and that flower keeps weeping that she is not being appreciated. Every work of art it becomes a great work of art only after being appreciated. Van Gogh became a great artist only when the people appreciated him. Till then, Van Gogh was nobody. So that the same thing is discussed in the later theories by in Bhatta Nayaka, Bhatta Lolata, or Sri Shankoka. Now here, at this juncture, when we are questioning the ontological status of the rasa, whether the rasa really exists or it is an imagination of the viewer, there is one question which has been raised by all these scholars, that where exactly the rasa stays? Is it kavyanishtha? Is it kavinishtha? Or is it rasikanishtha? If rasa has an ontological status, if rasa is an ontological reality, if rasa exists, where does it exist? Does it exist in the artist's mind? Does it exist in the work of art? Does it exist in the spectator's mind? If it exists in the artist's mind, how does it get transferred to the work of art? And if it exists in the work of art, how does it get it transferred to the spectator? Which means that rasa is not an object. When Bharata said rasa iti kap padartha, it is not a padartha. It is just a feeling. It is just an imagination. It is an imaginary state of mind, according to Lolota and Nayaka. They have discussed these things in details. We may not be able to discuss every detail of it, but there are some other questions which they have raised, which we will have to take into consideration. That when you see a work of art, or when you see experience any aesthetic expression, whether it is a sculpture, whether it is a play, whether it is a film, or it is a novel. If you are reading a novel, and if you do not know that language, will you be able to enjoy the aesthetic experience? Rather, you will not even recognize that writing as novel. So the basic requirement of a work of art is to understand it, sense it properly. Abhida is literal meaning. Abhida is principal meaning. If you do not have an access to the abhida of a work of art, it is practically impossible for you to enjoy a work of art. Now let's not forget one thing. Why I discussed the history before. In the previous session, we had a session on the history of aesthetic theories. This is the reason why I did it, because all these theories which we are talking about have been written in the early centuries of Christian era. Today we talk about abstract art, which is meaning free. Abstract art doesn't have any meaning, and that is why you can enjoy a painting by Rothko, you can enjoy a painting by Mondria without inquiring into its meaning. But those days there was no practice of creating art without meaning, and that is why meaning was an important factor of any aesthetic experience. So initially, when you encounter an aesthetic expression, the first requirement is to understand its meaning. Now meaning, understanding the meaning, is an intellectual process. It is a buddhigamya activity. It is you understand the meaning with the help of your intellect, not with the help of your emotions. Ne? Isn't that true? It is an intellectual activity. And when the bhava jagruti, the arousement of your feelings, the activation of your feelings, is bhavanika. It is based on sentiments. Now these are two different activities. So you enter into the art activity using your intellect, and come out of the art activity surrendering your emotions. It's a very, very curious travel. So all these observations are very, very interesting. But how do you change your track from this intellectual entry? How do you shift to the emotional experience that needs to be inquired? And Lolota has given a very, very interesting explanation of it. He says that the first encounter with the work of art starts with abhida, that is understanding the principal meaning. Then once you understand the principal meaning, you switch over to bhavana. That principal, when you read a poem, after understanding the principal meaning of that poem, you start understanding the emotions in it. And once you understand the emotions in it, you switch over to charvana, because only understanding the emotions is not enough. You will have to chew those emotions again and again. Again, here the analogy of food will have to be given. If you put the food in your mouth and gulp it down, will you get the enjoyment of it? To enjoy the food, you will have to chew it. You will have to keep it in your mouth. That charvana is very important to relish the food, to enjoy the taste of the food. Similarly, a work of art needs to be chewed. Just if you stand in front of a painting and walk away, you are not going to get the enjoyment of that painting. You will have to look at it again and again. The cow, charvana, that you know, that all the grazing animals, they just gulp down everything, and then at the time of leisure they keep testing it again and again. A work of art, an experience of work of art is very similar to that, that you will have to visit the work of art repeatedly, and at every time you will find something new in it. I'll give you an example. I remember when I saw the Persistence of Memory by Dali for the first time, I was quite impressed. Those folded watches hanging on the branches of the tree, all of you have seen that painting. It's one of the most well-known paintings of the world. And I was quite impressed by that painting with all that idea. And when I saw it again, after quite a few days, rather I kept seeing that painting quite often. And after a year or so, I noticed that the things which looked like the spare parts of the wristwatch are not spare parts. They are small insects. And then that added a different dimension to my experience. All these days I was looking at that painting, but after that moment I started looking at that painting from a different perspective. I could see a new dimension of that painting. This is true for all the works of art. The stories which you heard, the Mahabharata stories which you heard in your childhood from your grandmother or mother, now and the Mahabharata serial which you perhaps saw in your school days, if you read Mahabharata at this juncture, you will understand the depth of Mahabharata afresh. We know that what we understood when we were the child from years, it's total. Now go to Mahabharata and you will realize the depth of Mahabharata. And perhaps if you read Mahabharata at my age, you will again find another dimension of Mahabharata. A great work of art has a capacity to give you new experiences at that time. And that is why that popular saying, Kshanai Kshanaiya Navatam Upaiti Tadiya Rupam Ramaniyataha, what is beauty? The capacity of giving new experiences at every juncture is a symbol of beauty. So so keeping this in mind, Charvana is very important. So you understand the work of art, you switch over to your emotions, rather you try to enhance and you try to awaken your own emotions and then enjoy your own emotions at leisure, and that gives you the aesthetic pleasure. Now what Lolate is trying to tell us, I think he has told the thing in a slightly hurried manner. Later on in 20th century, I. Richards had said something which is extremely similar to Lolate's thinking. I. Richards says that an encounter with the work of art starts with sensation. Now, he has switched over to sensation from Abhida, obviously because he is a 20th century scholar. Being a 20th century scholar, he knows that it is not only literary arts or arts with meaning that he is trying to deal with. So when you see a sculpture, it is not the meaning that affects you, it is the shape, it is the form, it is the texture. There are so many other factors other than meaning that affect you. So it is sensation, and meaning is also one of the sensations. When you are talking about the meaning is one of the sensations, but there are other sensations also. So the encounter with the work of art starts with sensation. You sense it. Sometimes you sense it with your eyes if it is a sculpture or a painting. You sense it with your ears if it is music. Now if you are listening to instrumental music, there is no question of meaning. It is just a sensation. So sometimes it is an auditory sensation, it is a visual sensation, it is an so there are different types of sensations when you read through a work of art or look at a work of art. So the process starts, the aesthetic process starts with sensation, according to I. Richards. The next stage is tied imagery. If you are reading a novel, what exactly happens? You start creating images in your mind. If that novel is, say, Hemingway is describing a port. You know that a lot many stories of Hemingway have been written on about the sailor's life, now old man and the sea. And Hemingway starts describing the life on the seashore. Now when you read all those things, you start creating images of all that description. With the help of that description, you start creating those images in your mind. But this imagery is only limited to the imagery that is being imparted by the author or by the artist. So, and that is why he calls it tied imagery. Initially, the process starts with tied imagery. Now this tide, the process doesn't stop over there, because the seashore which Hemingway has seen and the seashore which you have seen are different seashores. If somebody is describing a classroom in his novel, the classroom, he is describing the classroom which the author has seen. But you too have seen the classroom, you have your own experiences. So naturally you will supplement the imagery which is being given to you by the artist with the imagery which you have in your mind, right? And that will trigger off your imagery in a free world. So that tide imagery will lead to free imagery. So the sensation leading to tide imagery, that leads to free imagery. Now this free imagery leads to references, because once you get into the world of imagery, the images always have references. Now if I see this chair in Baroda, probably I will be immediately reminded of Agra. Or if I see a particular stone carving in any part of the world, it will immediately remind me of my days in Agra. You get my point? Images have references, images have context, and those images trigger off those context, those references. From tide imagery, you are led to free imagery. The free imagery pushes you into references, and these references lead you to emotions. When Lolota told us that the travel starts from Abhidha and ends at Bhavana, how exactly that travel takes place is explained by I. Richards. Not in the context of I. Richards doesn't know about rasa theory, doesn't know about Lolota's theory, but he is trying to understand it in his own way, and there is a very interesting parallelism between the two. So I think to understand Lolota's theory better, we can refer to I. Richards, because he has explained it in a very convincing manner. So once you start getting into that free imagery, it leads you to emotions, because the days which I have spent in Agra have given me some emotional experience also. Or if I want to give a very simple illustration, a particular chair, perhaps if your father, I give this example often, that if my father used to sit in a particular chair, and if I see that chair or a similar chair elsewhere, immediately I will be reminded of my father. And if I am reminded of my father, which is a free imagery, it will obviously lead me to emotions, because I have an emotional bond with my father. Do you get my point? So that free imagery will push you into emotions. The different references, and those references will lead you to emotions. Once you get to those emotions, those emotions will obviously and inevitably lead you to an aesthetic attitude. He calls it aesthetic attitude, a very interesting word. He has created a very interesting word, that once you get into those emotions, yaadon mein kho jana kehte hai na, you will get lost in those emotions, and that particular mood will lead you to an aesthetic experience. So you started with a simple sensation that was offered to you by a work of art, and finally you entered into a mental attitude where you had the aesthetic experience. So how an intellectual activity results into an emotional activity, to observe this is a very, very interesting. This journey is very, very interesting. So which means that the rasa is not an object, it is a process. So, and that is why they say rasanam rasa, the process of getting aesthetic, the aesthetic experience is not rasa, the aesthetics is not rasa, the process of getting aesthetic experience is rasa. This is one of the possibilities that have been suggested by some of the scholars. There are so many discussions. Rather, rasa theory has given triggered off so many different views on art that you can study them for years. But we are going to discuss only three or four scholars. We have already talked about Nayaka and Lolota. And there is one more scholar that we want to discuss in this context, is Sri Shankuka. Shankuka is a very important scholar, because he has a very different perspective about art. And I personally find it very important, because he has given a fitting reply to Plato. Now, we'll be talking about Plato and his theory at a later juncture when we discuss Western aesthetics. But I'm sure that some of you must have read something about Plato or studied Plato, who considers artists as lesser beings. Plato has made very serious accusations about the community of artists. He says that artists are imitators, nakalchi, nakal karte rehte. What artists do? They make human figures like human figures. So they see a human figure, prepare a human figure like another figure. They see a chair, they make another chair. They see a glass, they make another glass. What is this? This activity is an activity of imitation. They don't have any intellectual capacity to create something on their own, because whatever they create is found in the nature, and the nature itself is not a reality. Plato believed that the nature, we will discuss this in details at a later juncture, but Plato believed that there is an ideal world which he calls archetypal world. This world is a copy of that ideal world, because just try to imagine the first ever glass that was created in this world. How did it happen? When the first glass was by somebody, what he must have done? He copied an idea. The idea of glass finally led to the actual glass. So the idea has to be there. The reality is the idea. Glass is the imitation of that idea. So he says that this world is the copy, is the imitation of the archetypal world, the ideal world. And the artist is copying the real world. So he is copying the copy. It is an imitation of an imitation, which is twice removed from reality. So he considers that the artist community is a very ordinary community. It's a brainless community. It doesn't have a capacity to create anything on their own. So they keep copying the world around them and be happy with it. Not only that, he says that not only the capacity, but they do not also have the will to look for the ultimate knowledge. Because for Plato, it is a moral responsibility of every human being to search for the truth and the absolute knowledge and absolute truth. And he believes that the mankind gets this knowledge through four stages. There are four stages. I will give you an example of a child. How does a child get the knowledge? A child, a newborn child. Now, the child cannot speak, the child cannot walk, the child cannot talk. How does the child starts getting the knowledge? He gives different examples. He gives an example of a cinematographic cave. But since we are not going to discuss Plato, I am not bringing all those things. I am just giving you a simple illustration. The child learns about the world through the images. If a child is separated from his mother in the childhood, do you think the child will ever understand about the mother? No. Which means that the mother and the child do not have an inseparable relationship. It is a cultivated relationship. They have a physiological relationship, but emotional relationship is cultivated relationship. Intellectual relationship is a cultivated relationship. So the image, he knows something, that image comes to him and feeds him. There is another image that comes to him and fondles him. The third image comes to him, picks him up. The fourth image comes to him and claps to him. They are images. The child doesn't know that this is his father, this is his mother, this is his brother, this is a sister. Nothing. They are images, objects. The objects come over there, they entertain him, go away. Gradually, when the child grows up, when it gets 3 months old or 5 months old, then it starts recognizing those images. And later on, when it goes to the age of 7 or 8 months, then he starts uttering words like papa or mama. Then he knows that this is mama, this is papa, this is fan, this is whatever it may be. Ghoda kidhar hai, pankha kidhar hai. All those things are understood at a much later juncture. So initially the child starts gathering the knowledge through images. This stage is identified as aikashia by Plato. Aikashia. Aikashia, icon or icon means images. So learning through images is the first stage of knowledge, which is known as aikachya. The second stage is pist, where these images are associated with some information. As I told you, that when the child becomes 1 year old, he starts using words like papa aaye, mummy aaye. He comes to know that ye ghar hai, ye pankha hai, ye ghoda hai, the doggy kaha hai, and then the child points at the doggy. So he is associating a certain word with a certain object. But does that mean that he really understands what dog is, or what fan is, or what is the function of the fan, or what exactly is the role of motherhood in his life? No, it is just words. The word and the object, they are being coupled together. That's all. This is the only capacity the child has developed by that stage. And this totally depends on personal selection. Now, personal selection, personal opinion. Why personal opinion? Because the information is being given from hundreds of sources. Like, if a child is, the child is being entertained by 10 different people. If he is being entertained by his grandmother, and if a dog comes over there, so the grandmother would say, ki, "Dekho kutta aaya." And there are, if his mother is there, perhaps his mother would say, ki, "Doggy aa gaya." The third person might call it something there. Koi kahega moti aa gaya, koi kahega. Now, isn't it very confusing for the child that the same object is being shown to him and 10 different people are giving 10 different informations about that object? Now it becomes a first challenge for the child to decide which of this information is to be accepted. And what is the criteria does he have? Does he have any criteria to decide which of the information is correct? He doesn't have the mental capacity, he doesn't have the intellectual capacity to discuss. I am saying he, but actually it could be she also. So he or she, the child, does not have the intellectual capacity to decide which of the information is acceptable and correct. So naturally, the child will totally rely on his personal choice. She or he would decide whether to follow the mother, or whether to follow the grandmother, or whether to follow the brother. Isn't it? If you try to teach something to your younger brother who goes to primary school, and try to teach him mathematics, the reply, I'm sure you must, many of you who have younger siblings must have received this reply, ki nahi, madam ne aise nahi kaha. He believes the madam. Even if you try to teach him something better, something more correct, the child would depend on the madam. Madam ne aise nahi kaha. So, because he had chosen to trust the madam, trust the teacher, not you. And why? Does the child really understand that the madam is more intelligent than you? No. It is only the choice that decided, trust the teacher, not the... Do you agree with me? So this is very interesting, that this subjectivity, this fear of opinion is very important in the second stage. So initially aikachya, where the child gets the knowledge through images. Then on the second stage is the pistis, where the information is coupled with the images, but the information is filtered through subjective sphere. It is a fear of subjectivity or sphere of opinion. Plato calls it sphere of opinion. Both these together, aikachya and pistis together, is called doksa. Doksa is the subjectivity of an individual. At that juncture, the man enters into the conceptual area. The conceptual barrier appears at doksa. If you do not cross that barrier, you cannot enter into the world of concepts. You will remain happy with the images and the information regarding that image. Once you cross that, it is like, you know, that when a rocket is sent to the space, it has to cross the gravitational barrier, then only it can enter into the space. The same is true about human intellect, that if it crosses over that doksa, then only the human mind can enter into the realm of intellect, intelligentsia, the realm of intellect. So there he says that then the realm of concepts, and then you also go beyond the concepts and reach the realm of episteme, that is the knowledge. I'm not going to discuss these things in great detail because we are going to discuss them once again at a later juncture. But did you understand that it is Aikashya, Pistis, Doksha, barrier of Doksha, and then the world of knowledge. Plato is of the opinion that the artist community is happy with the images and their personal understanding of those images. They do not want to cross over the Doksha and enter into the world of knowledge at all. What we express, you know that even sometimes in the contemporary times, there are so many artists who express their opinions about the social problems. But do they really understand the social problems? Do they really study the social problems? I have seldom come across artists who have really tried to understand the, in Baroda, I'm not criticizing any movement. I'm just trying to give you an example. That all the artists who were protesting against a certain, the, all the artists who are trying to comment or who are trying to opine on a political situation or a social problems, do they really have a deep and coherent understanding of that problem? Very few people have it. They are in a hurry to give their opinion. They are in a hurry to express their opinion. And naturally, that opinion is a very, very subjective opinion. They take sides because they get influenced. Like the child gets influenced by the teacher, they too get influenced by some activist community and start opining on those problems. There are exceptions. There are some artists who are intelligent enough to understand all the intricacies of that problem and then give an opinion about it. But a large number of artists do not have it. I can say it very confidently. This precisely is being criticized by Plato. He says that the artists are trapped into the images and their subjective world, their personal opinion. And that is why it is practically impossible for an artist to enter into the realm of knowledge. They cannot get it, they do not want to get it. And that is why the community of artists should never be treated as a respectable community. It's not a respectable community, it must not be invited to the utopia, that is the ideal world. He says that there is no place for the artist in the ideal world. They should not get any space over there. It's very humiliating for the community of artists, but Plato is very, very critical about our community. Now, the argument is quite logical, and the artist community could not reply it for a long time. Of course, Aristotle tried to contest it in his own way by giving a different perspective to art. But Shankuka perhaps is the only aesthete who has given a fitting reply to Plato. It's very interesting that Plato used epistemology in support of his views and conclusions. There is another scholar who is more than 1,000 years away from him, is using the same methodology to prove him wrong. They are distant in time and distant in location also. Plato's period is 4th century BC and Shankuka's period is 9th century AD. There are 1200 years away from each other, 1300 years away from each other. Now, Shankuka also uses epistemology, Jnana Shastra, in support of his theory. But it is Indian epistemology. In Indian epistemology, Jnana Shastra, he says, he's talking about Jnana. And he speaks about the four different types of jnanas. There are four stages of knowledge. He is talking about four aspects of knowledge. Shankuka is talking about four aspects of knowledge. He says that the general knowledge, normally most of the knowledge that we gather from our surroundings based on sadrishya, similarity. What we gather, whatever we learn it with the help of similarities. You straight away came into this room and sat on that chair. Did you really check that what you sat on for the chair? You have seen thousands of chairs and naturally you recognize that chair as a chair. Most of the things we learn with the help of our earlier experiences. And by comparing our earlier experience with our fresh experience, we draw the conclusions. Sometimes with the help of the similarities, sometimes with the help of the differences. If two things are similar, we draw different conclusions. If they are different, so most of our knowledge is based on the recognition of similarities and differences between objects and events. So that is called sadrushya jnana. That is our major knowledge, sadrushya jnana. But many a times this sadrushya can be deceptive also. Every time sadrushya cannot convince him, because there are things which apparently are similar but not exactly the same. If you are walking on the road the night time and see a serpent on the road, you obviously get frightened. The next day and return home. Next day morning, when you go out again, you realize that what you saw at night was not a serpent, it was a piece of rope which looked like a serpent. So at night, the knowledge that you gathered using the sadrushya jnana, using the similarity between the object that you saw and the serpent, turned out to be a false knowledge. It was not a real knowledge. So this knowledge is called mithya jnana. Mithya jnana. But this mithya jnana many a times is born of samshaya jnana. Many a times you have doubts. You see the similarity or you see the differences, but do not reach any conclusion. You keep wondering what exactly is true. So there is sadrushya jnana, there is samshaya jnana, there is mithya jnana. The knowledge derived from similarity, the knowledge which is doubtful knowledge, and the knowledge which is false knowledge. When you go beyond all these three things, you reach the samyak jnana, that is the comprehensive knowledge. The next day morning, when you saw the rope, you came to know that your samshaya at night, there is no more doubt, there is no more mithya jnana. Now you know it for sure that it is a rope, so that is a samyak jnana, the coherent, complete knowledge. So there is sadrushya jnana, there is samshaya jnana, there is mithya jnana, and there is samyak jnana. Now he gives this understanding of jnana shastra to us, and we keep wondering that why Shankuka is talking about all these things while talking about art. He raises a question at this juncture, that he says, when I draw a horse using chalk or using any material, and what kind of knowledge that horse gives you? A pictorial horse. He calls it Chitra Turaga. Chitra Turaga is pictorial horse, a horse in a painting. When I paint a horse or when I draw a horse and ask you what is it, you immediately tell me it's a horse. Is it really a horse? Can you ride it? Actually, you should have asked these questions to yourself. When I asked you what is it, you should have told me that it is a combination of zigzag lines which looks like a horse, because it is not exactly like a horse. You cannot ride it, you cannot lead it to your home. You do not have any doubt in your mind whether it is a real horse or it is not a horse. Or it is not also a question of, it is not a case of mithya jnana, that initially you thought that it is a real horse and then later on you came to know that no, it is not a real horse, it is just a picture of a horse. Was that so? It wasn't. You always knew that it is a picture of a horse, but the moment I asked you, many a times I will just give you a suggestion and it may not even have all the four legs or a tail. Even a simple stroke which slightly looks like a horse, you may recognize it as a horse. The Picasso's bull, that cycle handle and the seat, we call it a bull without questioning. Now, if it is a bull, where are the legs? Where is its body? We don't ask any of these questions. We immediately recognize it as bull. Now, what is this? Now, are we mad? Don't we have a basic understanding of epistemology? Don't we have a basic understanding of mithya jnana, samyak jnana, sadrushya jnana? He says that the simple thing is, it is a horse because I want to call it a horse. I call it a horse because I want to recognize it as a horse. I know it is not a horse. I know that it is not a horse, it is just a picture of the horse. But if I really want to enjoy that picture, I will have to recognize it as a horse. Similarly, when I see a character on the proscenium, when I see Rama on the proscenium, I know it for sure that the person who is standing in front of me is not Lord Rama. It is somebody else. I know that person. I know his name also. The other lady who is acting as Sita is also known to me. I know her name also. I know they are not husband and wife. Rather, they don't talk to each other. They hate each other. But here they are. All these facts are known to me. But if I keep thinking about those facts while watching that play, will I be able to enjoy the play? Will I be able to enjoy Ramayana? I will have to keep aside all those things. I know it is not Rama, but for those 3 hours, he is Rama for me. For those 3 hours, that lady is Sita for me. In ancient days, there used to be Ramlila, and most of the characters used to be men. I don't know whether you people have seen it in your childhood. But in the interval, you can see Sita smoking bidi, because the person who used to play the character of the Sita also used to be a man. So, but that did not disturb the villagers. If Sita is smoking bidi during the interval, the people, the audience was not disturbed about it, because they knew that at this moment, he is not Sita. Once he goes to the proscenium, then he becomes Sita once again. Now this wisdom, I call it wisdom, this wisdom is very, very important. This is the wisdom of a connoisseur. A person who wants to enjoy art must have this basic understanding that my participation in that activity is very important. If I don't participate, if I do not give sanction to that activity, art cannot become art. Art becomes art only when the connoisseur gives sanction to it. I call it art, and that is why it becomes art. I call it horse, that is why it becomes hot. I call him Sita, that is why it becomes Sita. There is a theory in 20th century which is known as willful suspension of disbelief. This is a Western theory, 20th century theory, which says that your disbelief, you don't believe everything in art, but you will have to keep aside your disbelief for some time. Uska ye bandh ke baaju mein rakh do, apna jo avishwas hai wo sara avishwas thodi der ke liye bandh ke alag rakhna chahiye, then only you will be able to enjoy the work of art. Otherwise, you'll all the time, if you keep thinking ki ye kahan se Ram hai, ye kaun si Sita hai, then the work of art is not for you. Then you go home and go out to sleep. Don't watch Ramlila. Ramlila is not for you. And there are so many assumptions which you accept. In folk theater, the protagonist and his wife, they say ki yahan pe hame koi khana nahi mil raha hai, chalo hum Bombay jaake kaam dhoondte hain. And then they walk on the stage. They take 3 rounds of the stage and they say, chalo Bombay aa gaya. And or in the Hindi films, the small child is running towards the horizon and then the hero comes, the grown-up hero, Amitabh Bachchan saamne se daudke jaye, and all those 20 years in between are lost. The life of the actor is shown from his childhood till his old age in 3 hours, and you believe that. If you refuse to believe it, you can't watch a film. You are not a film goer. So the spectator, the connoisseur, should have this wisdom to see how a work of art is to be accepted. You have to give a sanction to the work of art, because the work of art is not the creation of reality. Plato is expecting something wrong from the work of art. He is expecting the artist to create another reality, which he is not supposed to. The artist creates the illusion of reality, not the reality. He creates a convincing illusion of the reality. It is an activity which has nothing to do with knowledge. If you try to evaluate art in the light of knowledge, probably it will be a wrong approach. Knowledge is a different activity. Aesthetics is a different activity. Aesthetics is free of knowledge. You will have to keep aside your knowledge. You will have to suspend your knowledge, keep it aside for 3 hours, and then perhaps after watching the film, you may go back to your intellectual world once again. So the participation of the viewer is one of the most important. As I told you, that in Indian aesthetics, this is one of the most important things that the Indian aesthetics could recognize right from the beginning, right from the days of Vatsyayana, that a work of art never gets complete without the participation and the anumiti, the permission of the spectator.